On December 16, 1977, eight women, known as the Willmar Eight, went on strike in Willmar, Minnesota after their boss refused to pay men and women equally. They sparked a debate for equal pay not only in Willmar, but all around the globe. Although these women did not get their original jobs back, they made a contribution to one of the first gender discrimination strikes in Minnesota. During World War II, millions of young men in the United States were called to serve in the armed forces. This created a spike in demand for women to enter the workplace. With men away to serve in the military and demands for war material increasing, manufacturing jobs opened up to women and allowed them to not be treated as second-class citizens. But this didn't last long. Women's employment was only encouraged as long as the war was going on. Once the war was over, they were once again replaced by male workers. Some companies, however, wanted to ensure that the women in the workforce would not lose their jobs when men returned home from war. However, some companies did not. This was a big issue for women. Once the war started, a man's income was not enough to provide for their families. This also affected equal pay. Prices rose due to inflation and wages decreased. But instead of men and women both equally losing, women received lower wages. Unfortunately, it stayed that way, even after the war ended. In 1960, the Kennedy New Frontier Program forbade government contractors from discriminating against any applicant or employee for employment on the grounds of national origin, color, creed, or race. In 1963, the Equal Pay Act was passed, which required employers to pay all employees in the same role regardless of gender. This act also provided equal rights in the workplace. However, the act was not mandatory for all jobs with several exceptions to the rules. This made it more complicated for women when looking for jobs to identify businesses and companies that not only fairly treated their workers, but also applied equal pay in their establishments. Citizens National Bank, however, where the eight women worked, did not follow the Equal Pay Act. This was shown in various ways. The women discussed issues they encountered around equality at the bank on their breaks. However, the conversation soon shifted about discussions about the discrimination. In the fall of 1976, a new inexperienced male bank employee was hired by Citizens National Bank. The female employees were told to train him and that he would eventually become their supervisor. His salary was $700 a month, while the same female bank employee's starting salary was $425 a month. The female bank employees were troubled by this hiring. Shortly after, in May 1977, the bank's female employees filed a gender discrimination claim with the Minnesota Department of Human Rights. The complaints were then transferred to the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, the EEOC. In late 1976, charges were filed with the commission. Shortly after, the first bank union in the state was formed by the Willmar Eight, the Willmar Bank Employees Association Local 1. In spring of 1977, the EEOC declared that there had been a reasonable cause to believe that there had been gender discrimination at the bank and that the board of directors agreed to negotiate with the women. However, negotiations did not go anywhere. Tired of the gender discrimination and unequal pay, the Willmar Bank Employees Association members voted to strike. On December 16, 1977, eight female bank employees went on strike in Willmar, Minnesota due to the unfair labor practices and discrimination. From December 1977 through the summer of 1978, day in and day out in Minnesota's frigid winters and hot, humid summers, they stood outside and protested. Many in the Willmar community despised them because of their actions, thinking it was wrong or unjust to do such a thing. "Please stay home, you married women. Single girls would like to work. Be fair." It was hard on the women that many in their home community did not support them. This disagreement in the community led them to lose friends, and one even separated from her husband. But through the troubles they went through, they stuck together through the two-year strike. When asked what kept them together during the strike, they stated anger or stubbornness. Sandy Trimmel stated another reason. They started their strike for themselves, but found out through the letters they received that they were really fighting for women everywhere.
Southwest State, there was two professors there, asked a list of questions that they could figure out why we stuck together so long. Good. And they had all kinds of questions, the religion and politics and, you know, family and where we grew up and how we grew up and just, I don't remember, it was a number of questions. And after comparing them, they still couldn't come up with anything why the eight of us stuck together that tight. And we just said, well, we were just all ticked that we didn't want to, you know, put up with this stuff.
The women were shoved into the national spotlight and started to receive letters from supporters from all over the globe, sharing their own difficult solutions and urging the women to continue to strike. They then plastered the letters on the walls of their base for motivation. They were featured in many national publications, including articles and talk shows, and were financially supported by unions and feminists. Even the Minnesota Education Association, who donated $6,000 to the women. Many other groups, including the National Organization for Women, NOW, and United Auto Workers, UAW, held rallies in support for the women. Individuals also collectively sent $30,000 in support of the cause and to impel the women to carry on with the strike. In January of 1978, John Mack, the Willmar 8's lawyer, was informed that the National Labor Relations Board, NLRB, had only found 3 out of the 6 merit practices issued. A year later, in March of 1979, the NLRB ruled that the bank was guilty of only minor violations of discrimination, and the 8 women were told that they would be denied immediate reinstatement and back pay. Later that year, the NLRB ruled that the strike was a result of economic reasons rather than unfair labor practices, and then found the bank guilty of only minor violations. The strike eventually ended that fall, and the Willmar 8 members filed for unemployment. By doing this, they dropped a discrimination lawsuit with Citizens National Bank. And although the Willmar 8 did not win the lawsuit, they did raise awareness for women's equal pay in banking in Willmar. As a result of the organized pressure by working women, in 1978, the Department of Labor officially targeted the banking industry as top priority for enforcement of equal pay employment. These women inspired collective action that can still be seen today. The Legislative Commission on the Economic Status of Women for the State of Minnesota, founded by Phyllis Kahn and Linda Berglund. This commission's role is to gather information about women in the workplace and to advise the legislator. The Willmar 8 helped fuel the early days of this commission and to help create a more just environment for women working in Minnesota.
You know, through all of this, the best suggestion I can give girls is you've got to get your education. You've got to do that because you don't want to have to be supported by someone else, and you know, to make your own way and therefore have stability that you don't have to put up with bad things that happen in your life.
45 years later, the Willmar 8, consisting of Irene Wallen, Sylvia Erickson Cole, Sandy Trummel, Taryn Novotny, Doris Beauchart, Shirley Salinkis, Jane Hargreaves-Ruthis, and Glennis Gorbuchka are nationally known as pioneers for helping spark the debate about women's rights in the workplace. However, the fight for equal pay and equal representation in the workplace is still not finished. With this fight, the Willmar 8 have shown us that we have come a long way from earning 57 cents for every dollar a man makes up to the current difference of 82 cents. Even though it is not the whole dollar, we still have these women to thank for these pioneering. Although these women are not a household name outside the equal pay movement, their behind-the-scenes work is still evident today.